Captain. All systems are now operating within acceptable parameters. Shall I take our ship into orbit?
Yes. Let's get out of here. Sweet. Against all odds, the unreliable takes flight.
We have received a communication request from Dr. Phineas Wells.
Oh, good. I've been waiting to hear from him.
Aha, there you are. Hale and hearty, and captain of your own ship. I see you're putting the unreliable to good use. Shame about her former captain. Horrible way to die. How are you feeling, by the way? I lost track of you in that cave back there. Experiencing any unnatural drippage? Perfectly normal side effect of thawing, I assure you.
I got an OSI vial. I've been feeling a little lightheaded. Also, I can slow down time.
Oh, that, yes, that's probably permanent.
Good.
I wouldn't worry about it, though. I'm sure you're fine.
I like it.
What you saw in Emerald Vale is happening all across the colony. Food shortages, lack of supplies, and basic necessities. We're dying. The chairman, the minister, and all their lackeys on the board are to blame. The Hope has some of the brightest minds Earth ever sent us. If we can revive the Hope's colonists, they can help us undo the board's mistakes. They can help us set things right. You need to get to Stellar Bay on Monarch. I have contacts there. They'll help me, help us, find the chemicals to revive your fellow colonists. Gladys Kulkelly, lovely woman, runs a cozy little black marketing outfit on the Groundbreaker. She can get you a nav key to land on Stellar Bay.
That's good news. We also have to go to the Groundbreaker. You can now travel to Sella landing pad. We also need to go to the Groundbreaker for Vicar Max's quest. Why do I need a nav key to land on a planet?
Strictly speaking, Monarch is a moon, terraformed badly, and almost completely lawless. You'll love it.
I will.
Captains don't fly their own ships, you see. Your navigation terminal handles the, navigation. Think of a nav key as a set of flight instructions. The board's been confiscating nav keys for Stellar Bay, so we must rely on unconventional means of acquisition. Hence, Miss Gladys Kulkelly.
Can't I land somewhere outside Stellar Bay?
In theory, I suppose you could land your ship in Cascadia. And, in theory, I suppose you might survive the experience. Cascadia is utterly seething with dangerous, highly aggressive creatures more than capable of tearing you limb from limb. You'd have to be a lunatic to land in Cascadia, and I'm reasonably certain I tested your brain for incipient signs of insanity. Trust me, talk to Gladys Kulkelly.
All right. Sounds like a challenge, but I think I'll talk to Gladys first. What's stopping me from just leaving Halcyon altogether?
Without a skip drive? Good luck. You'll be dead before you make it to the nearest star.
Oh, no warp. Get Billy.
Look, I admire your optimism, but the sad truth is you're stuck here. You, me, and the rest of this colony. We're all skating precariously around the edge of oblivion together. None of us are leaving Halcyon alive, so we may as well make it a better place, and we can start by reviving the Hope.
Well, I could just get to his ship, steal his skip drive, and install it in my ship and get the hell out of here. Somehow I don't think that's an option. About this Gladys person, how do I know I can trust her?
Gladys and I have been doing business for years. Her smuggling credentials are unimpeachable. If anyone can get you a key to Monarch, it's her.
I don't like the idea of working with a criminal, though.
Criminals? Goodness no. Smuggling is a perfectly legitimate business venture. If misappropriating board property is a crime, well then, throw me in Tartarus. Plenty of ways to make money in Halcyon, you know. Not all are above board. Oh, above board. Above the Halcyon board. Get it?
Hilarious.
Ah, well, sophisticated humor, puns. Appreciation of puns is a sign of advanced intellect, you know.
Hmm. Fine. I'll go have a word with Gladys.
Excellent. I'll send her a wireless. Let her know you're coming. By the way, I gave Captain Hawthorne a disguise apparatus of my own design. Cutting-edge technology, years ahead of its time.
Hmm.
I call it the holographic shroud. I'm sure it will prove remarkably useful to you. You'll find it in the captain's quarters.
Oh, cool. You want to explain what a holographic shroud is? Like some kind of cloaking device?
Marvelous device. I'm quite proud of myself. The shroud changes the user's appearance to mimic that of another.
Oh, for my own self.
It has limits. First-generation technology, you see. But promising. Exciting to see it in use at last.
Hmm.
Very simply, the holographic shroud uses biometric information contained on standard identity cartridges to generate a holographic projection around you.
Okay. At first I thought he was talking about, you know, something for the ship. You mentioned this thing has limitations?
Only stands up to a casual scrutiny. Use it too long, bound to flicker, blur, something like that. Movement makes it more likely.
Hmm.
Best used in moderation. When you see guards in your path, you can't sneak past, for example. Maintain your distance. Act normal. No running, no jumping. Don't draw their attention. If they pay attention, they're more likely to notice flaws in the hologram.
Why do I need a gadget for this? Couldn't I just steal a uniform or something?
A change of clothes. What is this? Some old spy serial? Uh-huh. What inattentive and brainless guard would be fooled by such a shabby disguise? The holographic shroud masks not only your clothes, but your face and fingerprints. It modulates your voice and sweetens your breath.
How the hell does a hologram sweeten my breath?
Science, that's how.
People actually fall for this? It seems a bit far-fetched.
Ha 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 ha! The beauty is, they don't expect it. The shroud is the only one of its kind. We humans have a tendency to overlook the unexpected.
Hmm.
Activate the disguise, walk past someone. What do they see? A figure dressed like a fellow employee. Don't act odd. They won't focus on you.
Hmm. I'll put it to good use. Thanks.
Excellent. I'll contact you once you've found a way to get to Stellar Bay. If you have any questions, come see me in my lab. And remember, don't trust the board. They'll try to win you over with promises of wealth and power, but it's a lie. Hmm. The board's only interested in filling their own pockets.
No doubt.
Put a stop to them. They're going to run this colony to the ground.
Transmission ended. If you are ready to depart, please select a destination on your navigation terminal.
Got it. Is this the navigation terminal? Well, that's her. This is navigation. Before I go anywhere, I guess they've gone to their quarters? I want to go to my quarters. She's hanging out here.
Yeah, so this is my hiding spot now. I was looking for a place that was quiet. I figured the kitchen would be louder than the hold, so here I am. Cozy-like, ain't it?
What do you think of the ship?
That's in pretty good shape, considering how hard Mr. Hawthorne ran it. It's a Yakita LHA-120 A2 model, I'm pretty sure. The Block 2 design scooshed in extra cargo space, but didn't change the stock engines. Probably a touch underpowered, huh?
Hmm.
Accurate in all particulars. I conclude you are Edgewater's board-certified mechanic.
That's the ship's computer. It's not intelligent, but it does a good imitation. That sounds like a... That sounds like it. Yeah, I don't want to choose that. That sounds like an insult. Apparently, Ada's the one who actually flies the ship.
Fly-by-wire's pretty normal. Or, leastways, that's what I read in the trades. I've never been on a real ship before.
Hmm.
Hello! I am not a board-certified mechanic, but my dad was. He taught me all he knew. Do you understand?
Speech recognition is one of the many skills I have been programmed to simulate.
You're not simulating it, you're doing it! I asked a question and you answered it.
Yep.
I am gratified you consider this facsimile convincing.
What do you think, Parvati? Is this safe to fly now that we've got the regulator?
I don't see any holes in the hull. I'll take a good squint at her, make sure everything's tip-top. But I think we're cooking with plasma torches.
Mm-hmm.
You can do that, you know. My dad taught me how to make grilled cheese sandwiches with a plasma torch.
Did you learn your trade from your father? It sounded like it when you talked to Reed.
Mostly, yeah. I lived in the maintenance office near all my life. Mr. Thompson never let me forget how funny that was.
You worked beside your father your whole life?
Except for my schooling years, I was always beside him. Or tied to him. He used to carry me about in a sling when I was real little. When I got older, he set me to sorting tools and parts while he worked. Later, he taught me simple fixes like busted crate latches.
Did your dad ever work on spaceships?
Not on the regular. Once in a great long while, a Saltuna boat would break down on the pad. He'd always bring me along for those. Mostly, he did the same as me. Kept Bess, the cannery, running. Turned loaders, plumbing and electricity, some plastering. I never got the hang of that.
Reed seemed to have it in for you.
I'm not exactly a model employee. Not like he wanted. The kind that stays quiet and gets the right work done in the right order every day. It's not normal for anyone to do as their parents. You take a vocational test. That decides your schooling and your career. When I tested out for maintenance, everyone figured it was on account of my dad. They were real unhappy with us.
Why would people be unhappy about you getting a maintenance job?
Because they were hoping their own kid would get the job and get sent back to Edgewater.
Oh.
When folk go away for schooling, they don't get back to where they begun. Not usually. You go straight to your first job, wherever the company's got an opening.
You don't have any say in it at all?
I reckon you could say, no thanks, I don't want a job. But then you don't got a job.
One aptitude test determines your whole life?
They're powerful good tests. They rattled off this whole list of names who'd worked on them, with fancy bits hanging off them. Doctors and esquires and the thirds.
Thirds.
Even if you don't believe they actually catch what everybody's best at, everybody's got to take them. So at least it's fair-ish.
But you actually are good at this, and you enjoy it.
Well, I'm good at making things work the way they ought. Not so much at doing such to somebody else's schedule. There's times I'm working deep in the guts of a loader, getting it all running perfect. Then I look up to see it's tomorrow, and I've blown another deadline. Anyhow, I was happy to get back home. I didn't care much for schooling.
You didn't like your classes?
Oh, there were a whole lot of reading, not nearly enough doing. Like, before they'd issue you a wrench, they wanted an essay on the design of different wrenches. Then there'd be quizzes on company regulations for storage and maintenance of wrenches.
What did you do in your time off?
As soon as I got permission, I spent all my time in the machine shop. They had all manner of parts, but they didn't want me using them, so I had to sneak them sometimes. I even slept in there. Had a hammock tied up in the rafters. Before I left, I installed a little skylight for myself, so I could see the stars.
You didn't have your own room?
Students bunk four to a room. Supposed to get you used to working as a team. There's no privacy and no quiet. When my roommates tried to talk, I'd get so nervous I'd be drenched in sweat. It was easier for everybody when I stayed off on my own. I doubt any of them remember me now.
So after school, you moved straight back to Edgewater?
Yep, nothing much had changed. Everything was a little grayer, a little dirtier. Dad met me at the shuttle and gave me a big old hug. I noticed straight away that he was moving slower and stiffer. He made a little grunt when I squeezed.
Did you get much time with him after you got back from school?
About a year. I tried to do more of the work so he could rest. His heart gave him pains. Dad never said that he loved me, you know? I knew on account of him showing it. How he'd stay up late to help with my projects or listen to my fretting. Oh gosh, look at the time. Sorry to bend your ear so long. And I got so much to do before this ship's in decent shape.
I guess break time's over.
I could probably spend years fixing this boat, stem to stern.
Going up. I guess I'll take the stairs. Rampish stairs. So this is my captain's quarters. Sweet. Sweet. It reminds me of exploring my captain's quarters in Mass Effect. Edge of Order sign. Adelaide's deserters dreamed of an independent life without board in oversight. You taught them an important lesson. Never dream. That's a sad thing to teach somebody. That's the holographic shroud. Projects a disguise on you and your companions. Oh, cool. That gives you access to restricted areas, provided you have the correct ID cartridge for that area. Restricted areas are off limits to unauthorized personnel, otherwise result in being attacked on sight. Cool. That'll come in handy. For the groundbreaker, I'm sure. Phineas Wells mentioned that he gave a device to Alex Hawthorne, the holographic shroud. It uses biometric data from identity cartridges to project a disguise around you. This will be useful for gaining access to restricted areas. In order, here's the problem, we can't read this here. Should make it white, right? Whiter? In order, like a bright white, like more like this. In order to retrieve your fellow colonists stranded in hibernation, Dr. Wells needs you to travel to Stella Bay on the terraformed moon of Monarch. Monarch is interdicted by the Halcyon Holdings corporate board, so you'll have to procure a nav key through unofficial channels. Oh, I can put stuff in there. That's neat. Other than that, there's not much to see. I wish I could remove that. Sam? Ask Ada about Sam unit. There's no response from the auto-mechanical unit. A serial number etched in its chassis includes the letters Sam. That's interesting. So I gotta ask Ada about Sam. The empty man? Oh no, the cleaning machine. You found a non-operational sanitation and maintenance automechanical on the reliable. If you can get it running again, it may prove useful. A cursory search of the unit revealed the name Sam, but little else. Ada may know more. A stern older man with warm eyes, her Parvati's father. Banged up toolbox, full of modified tools with unique mechanical usages. Digging around in here would be an easy way to lose a finger to a sawtooth blade. Huh. I know, I'm taking her stuff. First wrench Dad ever gave me. She's been a friend ever since. The Modern Steel Wrench and You. This book is heavily dog-eared with doodles in the margins. That's sweet. That's weird looking. Oh wait, examine. Petunia the plant. This is not a petunia. I didn't realize at first because it was highlighted. Okay. So this must be the vicar's place? In a horrifying vision of the future, the board has been overthrown by the seditious and slovenly savages of Monarch. Only Halcyon Helen can rescue the colony from indolence and entitlement. Approved by the Ministry of Accuracy and Morale. Oh, I can sleep there. Hi. The Journal of Maximilian de Soto, Volume 1. The scribblings on these journal pages are utterly illegible to anyone except Vicar Maximilian de Soto. Doctrinal Studies 539 of Equity and Equations. These textbooks have been out of print for almost half a century. The margins are filled with scribbled notes, and many passages have been underlined. Some pages have come loose, the glue now yellowed and cracked along the spines. I love all these descriptions. I just need to borrow this. Like, forever. Index of Banned Literature. Part 1. Various Qualifying Considerations. Part 2. Principal Rules of Restrictive Management. Part 3. Morals and Maxims of Banning Unethical Literature. Part 4. Proof of the Grand Architect and Predestination. Refutation of the titles listed here within. Part 5. Consequences the Mind and the Will of Man when led astray. Part 6. Official List of Banned Titles. And Part 7. Prerequisites for Advancing the Investigation, Outing, and Penalizing of Offenders. OSI Anointment Vial. Sells suspiciously like iceberg aged whiskey. It said it added that. It added that to me. Oh, really? It just fills all this stuff in? What else does it want? Holographic shroud. Okay. Toss ball trading cards. In mint condition, most of these cards represent players from the Hephaestus Hammers and the Tile Backers. The Art and Science of Tossball. Impossible to put down. Order of Scientific Inquiry, Office of Literature. This endorsement has been approved. Auntie Cleo's Darlings. Signed by Seymour Whitlock, who held the record for the most on-the-field fatalities for 3 consecutive seasons. Jeez, fatalities. Oh, that's not a book. That's a sleep. Interesting. Very interesting. Oh, that's that. Alright, I'm gonna talk to him in a second. Stand by.
Yes, you caught me ruminating again. Guilty as charged.
That's all you ever do.
What's occupying your thoughts?
Nothing new, I guess. So, with his story, we get it pretty much right away. Parvati's story, apparently over time, or at least now. So apparently we have other people we can pick up. Because we've got empty cabins. So excited. This game is awesome. Oh, I got some stuff in here. Purple berry liqueur. Gently fermented, delicately distilled. Personal attributes plus one. And it goes hangover stuff. Gigantor energy drink. Now with extra caffeine. Mind attributes plus one, lasts 1 minute. When you need energy, you need Gigantor. Mm-hmm. So this is the bathroom. Before this was blocked, so what, I couldn't use the bathroom before? Okay. Sorry, that was a phone call.
We'll be here, Captain. Or will we? Haha. Just a little joke for you.
That's funny, though. I thought we took off already. Alright, so I have to talk about her, but talk to her about this auto mechanical.
Welcome back, Captain. How can I be of assistance?
Know anything about the auto mechanical gathering dust in the janitor's closet? Is that what that is? A janitor's closet?
The unit is a cleaning Sam. Hawthorne brought it on board some cycles ago, I'm sure with the intent to modify it. But I've never seen it up and running. Alex likely recorded progress notes detailing his efforts to modify Sam. If you check the terminal in your captain's quarters, we may be able to determine what work remains in order for Sam to properly operate.
Oh, did I forget to check that? I didn't check that, did I? I forgot. That's the problem. I tend to save like the best for last and then forget that I saved it to do. So yeah, I gotta check the thing. We got 7,200 experience just now. I'm in the mood for some entertainment.
Certainly, Captain. What would you like to hear?
Tell me a joke.
Why are obtuse angles so depressed? Because they are never right.
Okay. Play my favorite song.
Now playing a Spacer's Choice advertisement jingle.
It's not my favorite choice.
It's Spacer's Choice.
Yeah, I was about to say. Yeah, that's not my favorite song.
Everyone in Halcyon is contractually obligated to label this or another board-certified jingle their favorite song.
Oh, jeez.
Now playing a Spacer's
It's not the best
My pleasure, Captain. As you wish, Captain. I must comply with all direct orders.
I'd like to learn more about the colony.
What part of the colony would you like to discuss?
Phineas's orbital lab.
Yes. As Dr. Wells is a wanted outlaw, he built his laboratory into an asteroid. Orbital destinations can be challenging to land on. His more so than most.
Magneto did the same thing. Why is that?
The outlaw scientist known as Dr. Phineas V. Wells has taken a measure of precautions. To make the lab undetectable to those hunting him. Even knowing the location, my systems resist my orders to go where I instruct them.
What do you know about Phineas?
There is a bounty on his head, one with a markedly high reward amount. Shall I engage the laser weapon system?
To kill him? No, do not do that.
A sensible choice, as we do not have any laser weapons.
What? I want to ask about somewhere else.
Of course. What part of the colony would you like to discuss?
The Groundbreaker.
We are cleared to dock with the Groundbreaker if that's your desired destination. If we're going there, Please be sure all docking forms have been filed in triplicate and fees have been paid. The Mardets take their docking laws quite seriously.
You can take care of that for us, right?
I can, yes. Let me add that to my list of 1,435,498 tasks I am simultaneously executing in order to run our ship.
Great, thanks.
You are more than welcome, Captain.
Give me the spiel on the Groundbreaker.
The Groundbreaker was Halcyon's original colony ship. It has since been repurposed as a service station in the Lagrange point of the system. Freighters often deliver or pick up goods from the Groundbreaker en route to other destinations. The city ship hosts an array of cargo bays, factories, housing sections, and more. Many of Halcyon's companies maintain office spaces with station representatives in what is considered a truly neutral territory within the system. I have filed the required docking forms in triplicate, and fees have been paid.
Okay, good.
Of course. What part of the colony would you like to discuss?
Terra 2.
Where in Terra 2?
The only option is Emerald Vale and Edgewater.
Edgewater is the sparkling county seat of Emerald Vale, or it was when first built. Since then, neglect and time have worn away her shiny veneer.
Yeah, I noticed.
The town is near the coordinates where Captain Hawthorne died. It would not be unfortunate if something, like, say, a plague, were to wipe Emerald Vale from the face of the planet.
Oh, damn. What do you think of the townspeople?
You mean the ones who did not answer my distress call with medical assistance, but instead came to issue my injured captain a parking ticket? I'm sure they are wonderful humans who don't deserve to be wiped out by starvation or a devastating plague.
How is Edgewater faring since we left it?
Since you diverted power to Edgewater, the botanical lab shut down, and the deserters were forced to return to town. Meanwhile, the cannery's output increased, enabling the town's population to prosper. Thank you for nothing, Captain.
What'd you have had me done? Kill everyone?
I cannot say. First, I need to adjust my memory interpretation sensors, but I think my answer is yes.
Well, now that she's said that, I wonder if we can go back and if they have, you know, there is changes there that we can see. And if Adelaide is in Thompson's tower now. About somewhere else.
Of course. What part of the colony would you like to discuss?
Monarch.
Where in Monarch?
Stellar Bay.
Ah, Monarch. The armpit of the Halcyon system. Her last functioning port town is Stellar Bay. Well, that is if you don't count Sublight's Smuggler's Port at Fallbrook.
Smuggler's Port?
It's Sublight run for the purpose of shipping contraband. And before you ask, I don't know the coordinates, so I can't dock us there.
Why is Monarch being blockaded?
I believe it has something to do with the planet being an uninhabitable wilderness and a lawless land with no corporate presence. You may wish to survey the residents in Stellar Bay for additional data points.
Okay.
Of course. What part of the colony would you like to discuss? Where in Monarch?
Cascadia.
Warning. All colonists are urged to reconsider travel to Cascadia due to infestation of mantisaurs and risk of indefinite detention or death.
Sounds dangerous.
This is one of those times where you say one word but really mean another, isn't it? I suppose you would find an environment like this fun.
Any people live in Cascadia aside from marauders?
There are no people aside from marauders in Cascadia. There is only death.
Oh my. What's the local report?
The local report is that you will very likely die if you leave Cascadia's landing pad.
Alright, let's talk about something else.
How can I be of assistance? I have lots of minutes. Many minutes. Unlimited minutes, perhaps. Providing an adequate power source, I can function indefinitely.
What if you don't have a power source?
I prefer to think of it as being in a state of slumber. perhaps for an indefinite duration of time. Do you think that is what it's like for the colonists on the Lost Hope?
I guess so.
When I simulate myself in such a scenario, I do not find it to be desirable. I think my self-preservation protocols incline me to desire the alternative.
And what might that be?
Traveling the system with you, Captain.
What about your last captain? Do you miss him? Or is one captain the same as another?
Do you know what it feels like when the ship undergoes an unexpected power surge?
No.
A jolt to the system. I have felt that. I do feel that. As you may be aware, Captain Alex Hawthorne was a smuggler of some repute. I failed to predict the likely outcome of his reckless behavioral patterns. I should have predicted that. In our travels together, Alex liked to pass time by, as he called it, tinkering to improve my design.
Have there been other captains of this ship?
If you mean, was Captain Hawthorne my first? Yes, he was. How can I be of assistance?
Talk to you later, Ada.
See you soon, Captain.
Alright. So let's go back to my cabin. This time actually read my logs.